Thank you very much for supporting Talking Volumes and coming to the shows. It's so great to have you here. I told Stacy downstairs, I don't say this to all the authors, that the minute she was here for Cleopatra years ago, is anybody in the audience who was, yeah, good. And the minute I found out that she was writing a book about the Salem witch trials, I was like, we have got to have her. And everything revolved around when Stacy could get here. And it turns out that we are like one of two cities that she loves to come to. So I'm really glad you're here for this. The other thing is, this is weird. I have a soft spot for witches. And not just the bewitched kind, you know. I think of them as feminist ideals in some ways. Does anybody know what I mean by that? Yeah, yes, snapping it, way to go. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that too. When I ask you to think about a witch, you know, maybe from the movies or from literature, who comes to mind? Shout it out. We're casual here. Who? Oh, Macbeth. Who said Macbeth? That's the one I think about. Who else? Yes. Yeah, Wizard of Oz, right. I mean, if you start to think about how pervasive they are, right, in literature and popular culture, it goes a lot deeper than I think you'd imagine. So we have a lot to talk about tonight, and maybe I should just get on with it. How about that? The witches who appeared in Salem in 1692 were young girls, they were middle-aged men, they were mothers and daughters, they were people who were apparently on close speaking terms with the devil. Is there anybody here like that tonight? It's a good time. Yes, I'll be over there with the microphone a little later. Stacy Schiff writes, the more you resisted an accusation of witchcraft, the deeper you dug yourself in. There's just no getting away from it if somebody decided that you were a witch. She was last here at the Fitzgerald Theater, of course, for Cleopatra. The new book is titled The Witches, Salem, 1692. Please welcome her back to the Talking Volumes stage. I have no place to put my cocktail. Emergency.
I can hold it for you if you like.
Yes. I really had not thought about what I was saying to the audience about how pervasive witches are in literature, in serious literature, not just popular culture. I know that's something that you've thought about.
In literature, in opera, all the really good roles seem to go to witches. I mean, what does that tell us?
What does that tell us?
You know, I think in part, this is how I came, you know, in that strange, convoluted, perverse way that one gets from Cleopatra to 17th century America, which is perfectly obvious to me. When you talk about women and you talk about power, somehow the word witchcraft automatically seems to arise between the two. And in fact, even today, if you look at the press, whenever you have a woman who is said to be very accomplished or spellbinding, or she's never charismatic, she's spellbinding.
I mean, right.
the sorceress stuff seems to come up a lot.
Right. These women that were in 1692 in Salem that were accused or feeling like they were experiencing witchcraft were taking on a kind of power and self-authority. Right? That must have been very threatening to the community.
Many of the people who are accused are clearly, you know, it's hard to say because there are male witches, there are all kinds of people accused, but many of the women who are accused are clearly the sharp-tongued, the sharp-elbowed, the defiant, the cantankerous, the woman who didn't quite fit in or who perhaps was a little less conciliatory than she might have been. The woman who asked the carpenter to actually fix that joint three times over as opposed to just paying the bill, she got accused of witchcraft.
That quote that I read in the introduction about the more you resisted an accusation of witchcraft, the deeper you dug yourself in. There was really no way out for a while.
The peculiarity of the witchcraft accusations in 1692 is that you're being accused of deeds that happen in someone else's imagination, basically. You're being accused by a core group of girls who seem to have some kind of spectral sight. And so you could be standing in a courtroom and think that you're simply standing before the justices, but the girls will point at you and claim that you are conversing with an invisible devil whom they alone can see. And for various reasons, which we can talk about, the justices will privilege their testimony over yours. So the justices will somehow seem also able to see or believe that they see this spectral figure whispering in your ear. So if you're up against something that no one else has to prove, you have no alibi. And essentially what happens under those circumstances, yes, is that your case is hopeless.
As you're explaining that, I'm thinking, if you look into more contemporary history and you think about witch hunts, it's not all that dissimilar. If you were believed to be a communist, you had to prove a negative at one point in our country. I mean, there's other eras like this.
I think in any situation where you are said to be something that you are not, and are not given the means to deny that, yes, it involves some sort of witchcraft. The difference I would point out is that there were communists. There presumably were no witches.
Okay.
So,
presumably,
some of
you
us
said.
Believe. I tend to believe there were no witches. But in other words, in some cases, these are overstated threats. In some cases, these are delusional threats. And this is a case of a religious idea taken one step too far in a situation where, for different reasons and because of different people's agendas, the prosecution is ruthless and absolutely across the board hell-bent on doing what it's doing.
Sexuality simmers through a lot of this, and I think at one point you say, the battle for a thrashing, moaning young woman's soul certainly titillated some at her bedside. How present was this simmering sexuality that nobody was really going to be open about?
Here you have me out on a speculative ledge. These are teenaged accusers. These are all girls between the ages of 12 and 20, accusing their elders, accusing men in the community. Nothing on paper connects any of those girls with any kind of sexual abuse. Many of them are orphans. Many of them are living in homes without their biological fathers. On the court records in the prior years, there's a tremendous history of sexual assault. Any number of women battle, you know, the lascivious swineherd or the other servant in the house. Servants are abused by their masters regularly. So there's a lot of violence against women in this society. If you look at the girl's testimony carefully, a lot of very sexualized vocabulary gets used. The girls
right.
are poked, they're prodded, their pitchforks are thrown on them, people have wrestled them onto their laps. There's a lot that's sexual. I mean, there's one point where the girls in the courtroom tended to convulse and to fall into trances and to writhe or to have their limbs go rigid. And there's one spectacular moment of a teenaged girl in the courtroom with her legs sort of soldered together, and you have these adult men trying to separate her knees. I mean, a lot of this is slightly sexual. So do I see an undercurrent there? Yes. Do we have any definitive proof that any of these girls was acting out of any kind of, you know, abuse? Not really. There's an interesting piece in the testimony where the girls are clearly accusing a man, in this case a minister, of witchcraft, and he's said to be the wizard who's at the heart of this whole conspiracy, who had abused his wives. Mm. And it's almost, and everyone in the community knew that he had been a combative figure and a very difficult husband, a very controlling husband. And this is clearly some kind of vengeance being worked on him by women for the women whom he had abused. So there are all kinds of levels of sexuality here.
What did you make of the fact that a number of these girls that were accused witches were living without fathers? Did you draw any conclusion from that?
I think there's a lot to it. partly in the sense that you are just vulnerable in a society like this one, where a father figure would have meant so much. There's a stunning case of a girl who's bewitched the following year, bewitched, who is suffering the symptoms of witchcraft in 1693. And she is surrounded in her bedroom by well-wishers, which was normal under the circumstances. And at one point, she dismisses all the women, but she asks the men to stay. And there seemed to be a lot of that. There's another girl who will converse with an invisible devil, and she's saying to the devil, stop telling me that I'm fatherless. I know that I'm fatherless. So there seems to be a certain obsession with having lost that male protector in some way.
I get the impression from reading some of the testimony that includes descriptions of the devil that it was a very traditional, almost medieval kind of perception of what the devil was. Is that how you'd put it?
Yes, I would say that there is no, it's not the Miltonian devil. There are no sort of winged creatures here. The devil seems to be a relatively traditional figure. He can transform himself into all kinds of animals. No one's quite sure what language he speaks. There's a lot of confusion as to whether he's a dark man or whether he's a dark cat. You know, he's a transformative figure in many ways. He clearly is related in some way. An earlier witchcraft epidemic in Sweden colors what will happen in New England. And the New England devil in 1692 bears a striking similarity to the Swedish devil of several decades earlier. So there's a little imported devilology, or whatever you want to call it, there. And there's a certain consistency to his agenda in that he's offering his diabolical packs. Everyone's very clear that he offers a little book. It's usually red. And one signs in blood or in red or with the bark of a tree. But he proffers all kinds of fine things. And it's interesting that those are sort of customized bribes. I mean, he knows exactly what you want, of course. So to a middle-aged woman, he might offer ease and rest. And to a child, he might offer fine clothes or a trip to the Golden City. He pretty much knows what you're lusting for.
One of the things that I found really absorbing about the book is you're telling us about the economic and political circumstances that would have led people to be interested in the pact of the devil, to believe in some of these accounts of witchcraft, to feel isolated and afraid.
I couldn't get over how much of a state of siege these people are living in.
Right.
And how unfamiliar any of us is, I think, with what was happening in New England in 1692. I, anyway, knew relatively little of the political context, which plays a huge role here. And you're not even a generation after a really traumatic and bloody Indian war. Everyone either has lost a relative or knows someone who has lost a relative in the prior Indian war, and a new Indian conflict has begun. So the feeling that an Indian raid could take place at any moment is very real, and the frontier is about 50 miles from Salem Village at this point. So the sense that the world around you is in a state of dislocation and that menace is in the air is very pronounced.
I think it would be helpful to kind of describe the geography of, as you say, the frontier was 50 miles away. Salem Village is also removed.
Salem Village is a tiny community of farmers. It's about 550 people. 5 miles away from Salem Town, just to confuse the issue. You know, the thing with the Puritans is they always use the same names. Like, everyone in this book is named Mary. I'm really sorry, but there was nothing I could do about that. And there are two Salems. Salem Town, which is the seaport, it's a very refined port, quite wealthy, second only to Boston. And 5 miles away is a little village to which farmers have removed themselves in search of better land. They have no authorities, they have no civic institutions of their own. They rely on Salem Village to adjudicate their matters, which creates a certain amount of tension. And it is in that village of pretty much isolated households that the witchcraft will break out.
They've removed themselves, you say, to find better land, but isn't there also a feeling of not wanting to be controlled, I guess, by what's going on in Salem Town.
There's a terrific tension between the two that will come out during the trials.
Right.
In the sense of the farmers, for example, saying, why should we go to Salem Town to help keep the watch? We're the ones who are living on the frontier. The menace is at our front doors. And the town is really not very forgiving of the villagers for that defiance. So that going into the trials, there's a certain impatience with these combative, feisty, rather independent-minded farmers.
How remind me again of how recent the Indian Wars had been?
Really 15 or so years earlier with King Philip's War.
Are there members of the community that are still traumatized
Absolutely.
By that?
Absolutely. And more importantly, many of the girls who are suffering symptoms of witchcraft have known Indian raids from having lived further north in what is today Maine. And so they have known firsthand of these really gruesome raids. Everyone knows what we today call the captivity narratives of Mary Rowlandson, for example. Everyone has heard of, you know, babies smashed against trees and really terribly grisly incidents. And this is really part of the ethos at this point.
I mean, with those Indian raids, they would come out of, I mean, you never knew, obviously, when they were going to happen. They would come out of the darkness. They'd be dressed in frightening costumes or frightening wear. I mean, you can see why that would be a deeply traumatizing experience that is not all that dissimilar to some of what gets described with this witchcraft.
It's really, when you look at the witchcraft testimony, you see any number of people who either conflate witches and Native Americans,
right,
or who say, you get women who say, I've always wondered what I would do if an Indian came to the door. And if you look at the earlier court testimony, you have cases of women, an Indian tries to make off with the children and she tries to bash the Indian over the head. You get the account of a woman who's sitting in her parlor knitting and several Indians come to visit and she's cowering in the corner, terrified. You get any manner of people carried off from their fields. You get any manner of assault. And that would have been a very obviously floating in the air. There's a reason why the idea that these are horrid sorcerers and hellish conjurers, as one minister calls them, why they get caught up in the whole idea of witchcraft.
I want to talk about the perception of what a witch was, because this was really interesting. And you write about the influence that an English academic had over the idea of what a witch was in the 17th century. They would have, it's clear that they would have believed that witchcraft was very tangible, that you could, see it and feel it?
And that was really important for me to get across early on in the book. Yes, very palpable, but not, a witch is not a figure of superstition at this point. A witch is a religious construct, and she is essentially, he or she is someone who is essentially signed a pact with the devil, because of which she can do unnatural and malicious things. And she has a whole army of little familiars or imps which help her to accomplish her ends. But she's defined, there's an entire scientific literature of witchcraft to the point where all kinds of things about her are codified. The marks that she bears on her body are codified. Everyone knew that a witch couldn't recite the Lord's Prayer properly. And oddly enough, when any number of suspects appear in the courtroom and are asked to recite the Lord's Prayer, they can't do it, which drives home the kind of pressure these people were under in front of the authorities. A witch could not cry except for 3 tears out of her left eye. I mean, it's really specific material. And an English witch was different from a continental witch, and these are very much English witches, who did not fly until 1692, when there's a lot of flying in Massachusetts, which is another import from the Swedish epidemic. But yes, there's an entire science and literature of this. Any witch is not the pointy-headed crone we know today, but a diabolical accomplice.
You talk about the contradictory dimensions of what a witch could do and couldn't do. You say, they knew secrets for bleaching cloth, smelled figs in someone else's pocket, survived falls downstairs. They could be muttering contentious malcontents, or they could be inexplicably strong and unaccountably smart. You could not win if you were.
Some of us would be toast, yeah.
I know.
You know, there's a wonderful line said by her minister of the first woman to have hanged in Massachusetts, that she had had more wit than her neighbors.
Yes.
A hanging offense, in many circumstances, in fact. Those who were outliers, those who were oddities, even the minister whom I just mentioned, George Burroughs, he was a very small man. He's called Puny by one of the great Massachusetts ministers, but he has some kind of sinewy strength. And it doesn't seem as if it correlates to his size. And that seems, while that had seemed very impressive during Indian raids in 1692, when you're looking for a diabolical mastermind, it seemed suspect. So anybody who's on the margins in any way, among other people, is definitely suspect.
I want you to tell us the story of, how do you pronounce, Tituba?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. She's accused by a 12-year-old girl. I was just talking with somebody in the audience who is going to ask a question about the Crucible, but she shows up, right, in Arthur Miller's
She does.
Novel.
She shows up in a slightly different form. There's some wonderful scholarship about Tituba, who starts out in the historic version, in the real version, the original version, she's an Indian slave. By the time Arthur Miller writes The Crucible, she has become African American. How that is accomplished is slightly complicated, but in 1692, she is an Indian slave living in the house of the minister, where the witchcraft breaks out. And she's one of the first three people accused of witchcraft. The first three people accused are the three sort of obvious suspects. It's Tituba, it's a very contentious woman who tends to sue a lot, and it's a homeless beggar woman. So three relatively vulnerable people are the first accused. Tituba does something which arguably ignites the entire hunt or panic, whatever you want to call it. She confesses, and she's the first to say, yes, I've met with the devil in the parsonage, in fact. I've had these discussions with the devil. He's promised me these things. I have flown with him. A conspiracy is afoot, and there are nine witches in all. And of course, as soon as she has confessed to witchcraft, all kinds of people begin to see all kinds of things. Suddenly there's a reality to these accusations, and no one is then able to deny the fact that witchcraft is at work. Oddly, Tituba will go to jail after that testimony, and so far as I can tell, is never appealed to again in the course of the entire panic. She's the first into jail and the last one out 15 months later in 1693, when we lose all trace of her.
These accounts of people that are accused and confess, it's so, again, so relevant to modern history in some ways, because what are we learning about the criminal justice system? People say, well, why would they confess if they didn't do it? I mean, I'm amazed at how relevant a lot of this history is. Were you?
And every day I would pick up the newspaper and think either I have become simple-minded and I'm completely monomaniacal, or this is very relevant.
Right.
Or all of the above, exactly.
Right.
But the false confessions are definitely, I mean, a part of this. I was writing some of this during Guantanamo days. It's strangely easy to exact a false confession, and sometimes a very detailed, in these cases, false confession. There were a lot of reasons for it in 1692, which are rather original reasons for it. Sometimes people confessed because they were afraid of being thrown into the dungeon with George Burroughs, the minister I was just talking about, because even the people who believe themselves to be innocent think the other accused witches are guilty. So the idea that you could be thrown into the dungeon with a wizard was more terrifying even than confessing to witchcraft. Sometimes people, there's a teenage girl who rides off to her hearing with her minister on one side of her and her brother on the other, and both the men are saying to her as they ride, admit it, you're a witch. And the young girl saying, of course I'm not a witch. And of course, by the time they get to the hearing, she's admitted that she's a witch. a lot of people confess at a certain point, because if you do so, you don't tend to hang. So it's a way to save your life. And a lot of people confess because, as many of us do, they have stains on their consciences.
Right.
And when they confess, what comes out is not only diabolical collusion, but a bout of drinking, or an episode of adultery, or a theft, or a polygamy, or there are other little peccadilloes that come tumbling out.
I thought some of those confessions were just heart-wrenching. You can imagine the terror.
Yes.
And as you say, people who have done something that in this day and age would not be something to be ashamed of, but they're living with this sense of shame, and how exploitive.
Well, you know, I was struck too by two things: how exploitive, how everyone has something on his or her conscience,
right?
But also how
that's what we're going to talk about a little later. In the have people
you'll
stand
all,
up.
You'll all be filling out little cards, sending them up here,
that's
and
right.
Then we're going to point fingers. That's why you're here tonight,
exactly,
and not at the hockey game. And also how everybody has something on someone else,
right?
The New England memory, except when it comes to 1692, is a very long memory. And people tend to remember generations old, this is very true of an oral culture, obviously, generations old grievances and litigation. And a lot of things come tumbling out in 1692 that reach back 10 and 20 and 30 and 40 years.
Do you think that's still true to a certain degree of societies we live in?
I live in a New York City apartment building, and I have to tell you, we don't forget easily what happened on the seventh floor.
Really? I mean, you reminded me that, you know, that's how the Stasi stayed in business for as long as they did, terrorizing people so deeply that they would easily turn on anybody, including people in their family. There was some of that here going on in Salem.
There's a great deal of, you can feel the contagion of the terror.
Right.
And you can feel it to the point where you begin to see, or suspect anyway, that people are accusing because if they accuse, they know they won't be in turn be accused, which I think is very parallel to East Germany.
Right.
That you had the feeling that you were safer if you simply name. There were two reasons to name a name. You were safer. It was a great way of protecting yourself. And communal purity was essential. And it was your moral obligation, if you had a suspicion of your neighbor or of someone else in the community, to name names.
Let's say a little bit more about this idea of communal purity. I mean, is it something that the people that, would they have recognized as such among themselves? How was it thought of in the community?
By all means. And the minister in whose household this breaks out also inflames matters by making it clear that there are some, as he puts it, devils in the church. And essentially, in a finger-pointing sermon, calls on his parishioners to help expunge those individuals, without naming names. But it does give one the sense that there are people who need to be sacrificed for the sake of the rest of the community. But it's central to Puritanism that for you to be pure, someone else had to be impure.
That's right. I mean, did they have the sense that they were living to a code that was higher and purer than people in other parts of America at that time?
I would say that you can see American exceptionalism pretty much being born in this moment.
Yeah.
For better or worse. The same kind of defiance and feistiness that you see giving us a revolution in 1776, you see at work in 1692 when the ministers, rather encouraging a witch panic, indicate that it isn't necessarily such a bad thing that the devil has touched down in Massachusetts, because it's a sort of badge of honor, and it's proof that New Englanders are the chosen people. So this invasion of diabolical agents serves two purposes. It indicates that this is the greatest, most pious settlement in the world. Where will the devil go but there where he is hated most, says Cotton Mather.
I was just going to say, isn't that something Cotton Mather believes?
Of course, everything's something Cotton Mather believes. Yeah. That's why I love him so. And as many ministers had for years been prophesying the second coming, which was going to be preceded by diabolical spirits, here was proof that the second coming, about which also the ministers had been very exact in terms of dates, was afoot, because this was the plague that was going to beckon it into existence.
I can't wait to talk about Cotton Mather, but maybe the excerpt
first. Do we have that much time?
Huh? Yeah, I know. So interesting. So the first excerpt is early on in the book, and I love it's so vivid. And you said when we first started talking about this backstage that this is where the book was going to start. Why?
I thought I had to plunge the reader into what I had been living, which was to say cold, dark, inhospitable New England, immediately. I felt two things. I felt you had to make real, the witchcraft is so improbable and so preposterous to us. I felt you had to, it was my job to make it clear that it is very real to these people, and that these seemingly delusional events really strike them as perfectly possible. So I thought you had to go right to the heart of it. And I also felt that it gave you a sense of the lay of the land, that it was a sort of cheap way of giving a reader, sort of rocketing the reader into the story.
So why didn't that end up being the beginning of the book?
Because I have this really smart publisher who said, you know, you should probably write an introduction first. But being the canny and remarkably, what's the word? Non-law-abiding writer I am, I turned that into chapter one, not the introduction. So this is chapter two. Okay. I'm now putting on my eye bobs.
Oh, nice.
Skimming groves of oak, mossy bogs, and a tangle of streams, Anne Foster sailed above the treetops, over fields and fences on a pole. In her pocket, she carried bread and cheese. It was mid-May, 1692, after a wet spring, a chill hung in the air. Before Foster on the pole sat Martha Carrier, half Foster's age, and the dauntless mother of four. Carrier had arranged the flight. She had persuaded Foster to accompany her. She knew the way. A plush carpet of meadows and hillocks unfurled beneath the women as they flew southeast, across the Ipswich River, over red maples and blossoming orchards, the wind in their faces, a bright moon pasted in the sky. For years, Foster and Carrier, near neighbors, their families of Scottish descent, had attended the same church in Andover, Massachusetts. They traveled at high speed, covering in a flash ground that would have required 3.5 hours by a good horse, and then until recently had been stony and uneven, unpassable in the dark. Their flight was all the same not without incident. Aloft one minute, the women found themselves in free fall the next when, nearing a thick woods, their pole snapped suddenly beneath them and they plunged to the ground. Elderly Foster felt her leg crumble under her. Instinctively, she flung her arms around Carrier's neck, to which she held fast. In such a way, Foster later explained, and her account never varied in the slightest, the two women soared off again, to land safely in a Salem village meadow. The meeting had not yet begun. They had time to picnic in the grass under a tree. On her knees, Foster drank from a nearby brook. Theirs was not the first such aerial malfunction. 2 decades earlier, a little girl in Sweden, also en route to a momentous late-night meeting in a meadow, had precipitously fallen from a great altitude. She wound up with an exceedingly great pain in her side. Foster and Carrier overflew 12 miles between sparsely settled communities. That no one saw them streak through the sky made sense. That no one heard the crash was more surprising. Sound echoed and ricocheted through the New England air, which had an amplifying effect on the ear and the imagination. The slap of a beaver's tail against the water could be heard a mile off. The hideous noise with roaring of fat black bears carried far and wide, as did the screech of the crowd when a scaffold fell. Each disturbance begged for an explanation. That crash of the ocean in the landlocked distance? A flock of pigeons alighting in a tree. The freakish bellow? In Boston, Samuel Sewell discovered it to be the lament of his cow, bitten by a dog. Dogs howled nightly at marauding wolves, But sometimes the wild barking, the pre-dawn crack of timber indicated something more sinister. Sometimes it meant that board by board, the neighbors were disassembling the house next door, the deft resolution of a bitter property dispute. Who would have guessed that what sounded like a washerwoman beating her linen deep in the forest would turn out to be giant tortoises propagating? What I didn't want to say before I read that part, oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
What I didn't want to say was, I wanted to use it because of the broomstick crash. And as soon as I knew about the broomstick crash, I knew that was the first page of the book. And also that when I was writing it, I spent innumerable amounts of time with reference librarians trying to establish where the moon was, what shape the moon was in on May 15, 1692, for a flight, of course, that never happened.
You seem so, and I noticed this when you were here for Cleopatra, you seem so at ease in being immersed in the past. I mean, which is obviously a quality that biographers...
Are you saying I don't have a life?
Well, I'm wondering.
You would be right.
I'm kind of interested in your own character development and how that happens.
I'm afraid it might be an occupational hazard for those of us who are not hugely interested in ourselves.
Really?
It may come in handy in the writing of biography that you particularly like to inhabit someone else's life, or you prefer to inhabit, maybe that makes it sound a little parasitic in a way, that you prefer to inhabit someone else's life to your own. I think there's something there. It's not just empathy, it's also this wholesale dislocation, that you're wholesale moving to someone else's time and place.
Right. I mean, the distance seems to be something that...
I think I might just be a premature nostalgic or something. You know?
What do you mean by that?
I mean, I'm always longing for the lost world. You can't spend a lot of time in Hellenistic Alexandria without wishing you lived there.
Right.
So 17th century Massachusetts, is not necessarily as appealing an address. But there is something in that particular extract, the silence, the eerie silence, and the dark were something that I really just striking and utterly fascinating to me. You have people in court talking about how they are ear witnesses to things. That sense that sound and words were primary, which of course had something to do with getting all your news from the pulpit. But it was such a completely. It was an idea to which I was so unused and which I found to be so fascinating. So, I don't know, call it what you will, escapism of a kind, professional escapism.
It's so intriguing to think of you pressing these librarians for the specific details of where the moon was.
Okay, you want to know, it was even worse than that, because not only did I hound this poor and brilliant New York Public Library research librarian about the moon, but then I realized that in these 55 confessions to a diabolical Sabbath, which is where poor Anne Foster was flying when her pole crashed, no one ever said it was dark. So then, how disappointing is that? Not only are they not flying on a broom, they're flying on a pole, but it's not even dark out.
This could have been during the day?
It was presumably during the day, because they all confess to seeing. I mean, everyone is very big on the colors and the details, so they're clearly able to see. So yes, it would seem as if this manufactured Sabbath with the long table and the tankards and the sort of reverse communion ceremony takes place in broad daylight.
It's interesting that the flying is such a constant element through some of these accounts, right?
Well, as I said, it's new to New England. Continental witches flew, English witches traditionally did not fly. And the flying takes off, Tituba mentions it, and then no one really picks up on it for a little bit of time. And by midsummer, suddenly everyone is on poles or sticks or the devil's shoulders, and they're flying two and three to a broomstick, through a stick through the air to this meeting from as far away as Connecticut, in fact. And they're flying often with their families. I mean, that's the other rather appalling thing about Salem is that you have children accusing mothers and grandmothers, and often they will be flying with their families on these poles.
Well, I mean, what do you attach any kind of importance to the fact that that emerges in Salem, and it didn't seem to be something that the Swedish witches talked about?
Well, I'm afraid that I do blame Cotton Mather for that little piece of
yes?
it.
Yes?
Cotton Mather is the person who imports the story of the Swedish epidemic to Massachusetts in a best-selling book a few years earlier. So the imagery of that that invasion, that diabolical moment, which also is caused, I should add, by a 9 and 11-year-old child, so it's very similar in its origins, and many people are, in fact, persecuted in the Swedish witchcraft, that imagery should then be transferred wholesale to Massachusetts does seem to be a Cotton Mather contribution to this particular story. And what he doesn't mention, what he leaves out of his account, but was in the Swedish account, never makes it to Massachusetts, so it seems particularly suspect.
He seems to want it always. I mean, he urges caution, but if I remember right, he doesn't deny the idea that there are angels and creatures around, right?
He's a very brilliant young 29-year-old minister.
Is he a manipulative person too, would you say, or not?
I would not say he is manipulative. I'd say he's a fluent and complex thinker.
Okay.
Supple, you might say. So that in a document, he's repeatedly appealed to because he is so brilliant. I mean, this is a man who had graduated from Harvard at 11 and preached his first sermon, gone to Harvard at 11 and preached his first sermon at 16. And he's regularly appealed to by the authorities for advice on witchcraft and on the prosecution. And in the space of a single document, he's able to go from advising caution and moderation to making a case for serious and hasty prosecution. So there is a sort of, as it was later said of him, ambidextrousness to the advice. He is able to argue it from both sides.
What would have been his motive?
Well, this idea that New Englanders are the chosen people certainly is part of it. He will afterward, in 1693, he will write something that I'm surprised hasn't sort of stood out more in the literature. It's a very indicting statement, never meant to be published, but does come out, in which he basically will say months after the witchcraft court has shut down and everyone else is a little bit appalled by what has happened, he'll say, but really, nothing was lost in 1692. We filled the pews, God got new recruits, we awakened a slumbering generation, the devil got absolutely nothing, wholly forgetting the 20 innocent victims. So it is clear that it has not, and he's still, by the way, in 1693, taking the pulse of witchcraft cases, because the belief in witchcraft will not die in 1692, the idea that the court is infallible will perhaps take a hit. So, you know, he's very involved in this. The idea that there is an invisible world and that there are devils afoot is really inseparable for most New England ministers and certainly for Cotton Mather from the very idea of faith.
And I want to talk about that in a minute, but I made a little note here. At one point, Mather uses prayer to get rid of a son-in-law that he doesn't like. I mean, I asked you if he was manipulative because there were times when it seemed like he would embrace this kind of thing for his own ends.
There's a part in the book where I realized you had to address how superstition and magic and religion differ from each other.
Right.
Because they did, even to the 17th century New Englander, bleed into each other quite a bit. And what is the difference between putting a spell on someone or someone's oxen or someone's cattle and someone wishing that his son-in-law would drop dead, which he does, and not wishing, praying that his son-in-law will drop dead,
right,
which he does. So I'm afraid I used that a little bit against Cotton Mather. I hope I'll be forgiven.
But I want you to talk a little bit more about the intersection of religion and magic and witchcraft.
What the trials will uncover is an enormous amount of superstition. Many people in court will admit, when they're confessing to things, will admit to the use of magic. One Andover farmer, male farmer, who's accused is a professional fortune teller. And in fact, when he is called upon to confess, will make very clear that he spent more time reading palms and telling fortunes when he should have been tending his cattle. So that's the blot on his conscience, basically. And many men in the community there will admit they've spent too much time listening to him tell fortunes when they should have been tending their farms. Even initially, when the girls first begin to convulse and are believed to be bewitched, a neighborhood woman who belongs to the church will come by and she'll try a folk remedy, a superstitious remedy, on the girls to see if she can somehow identify who the witch is. So, as scholars have pointed out, there is a whole overlay here of superstition and of sort of mystical belief that coexists with this this fervent piety.
Although you were careful to say at the beginning of the discussion that these witches were not based in superstition. I mean, they were, again, tangible.
The witchcraft belief is pure religion. And the idea that a witch exists is as clear to these people as the idea that heat or light exists. I mean, the devil has a palpable presence. The devil is in confederacy with witches. And that is as irrefutable as is the existence of God. How to deal with the witch? There are matters which are open to a little bit of interpretation and superstition.
You said a minute ago that Cotton Mather, in the end, says, well, it all worked out and people turned up in churches. I mean, the church took a big hit because of this, right? And he obviously didn't realize what was going to be the result of that.
It's the legacy of Salem comes up in so many so many ways in the immediate and in the long term, but one of the immediate results, obviously, is that the experts don't seem quite as expert anymore. Mm-hmm. It is pretty clear to everyone that the justices have overreached, that innocents have perished, that this is a huge embarrassment, to say the least. The authorities, although we can talk about this, there are very few apologies. There are some heroes who will raise their voices at the last minute or in the last months, but the church will seem in some way blemished by this. The very idea of confession, which is so central to Puritanism, will be tainted. The door is open to religious toleration as it was meant to have been already because of this. It'll be much harder to be prosecuted for sedition after this.
I think you say, when this is all over and the spell broke, the torrent of recriminations swept away a rich layer of faith. The church was damaged as a result of this.
Very much so. Very much so.
How much time did you end up spending in Salem? Is the Salem that has been turned into like a tourist mecca, is that Salem Village or Salem Town?
That's Salem Town, which is a very good place to buy a broomstick or a set of fangs or a love potion.
Meet the town witch.
My first time there, I was in, I had spent the day in the archives, and at about 3:30, which is the worst time ever to be in an archive because you're starving and decaffeinated. I had stumbled out to get a grilled cheese sandwich or something, and I turned around and behind me was someone wearing antenna. this was July, and that was my introduction to Salem. It's a fabulous place, but yes, it has gone to town on its witchcraft history.
Well, what do you think of that, the commercialization of this?
It's a different kind of witchcraft that's being celebrated there. And it's a town in which two things can coexist. There's an extremely moving and very elegant memorial to the victims of 1692. It's really stunning and very evocative, just across from the Peabody Essex Museum, which is where the witchcraft papers are housed. And then a little bit down the street in the other direction, there's a gleaming statue to Elizabeth Montgomery from Bewitched. So you can have it both ways.
Did you go to see the recreations of the witch trials? You know,
yes, in the museum I did. I took one of my children, yes.
Is that done in the museum?
It's done in the church.
Right? Okay,
yeah,
right.
The consecrated church.
What'd you
yes.
think of that?
That was interesting.
And historically accurate, or?
I went back into the archives after that.
Did you?
Yes. It is historically, I don't know, because there are so many unknowns. There are so many things we don't know about how the trials take place. So figuring out how to recreate them is a little bit complicated. We have a lot of the courtroom testimony. Mm. That is not what's necessarily being used in the recreation.
Right. Are the archives, they're closed to most people? I mean, to historians like you, they would be available.
They're actually surprisingly open, and many of the documents are actually in facsimile form online. It's so easy to consult them.
Wow.
And to hold these documents and to look at these pages on which, you know, people are accused of having wickedly and maliciously and feloniously practiced witchcraft on their neighbors is astonishing. The writing, the penmanship can be a little bit taxing at times, but it's very evocative material, partly because you get these detailed confessions. Anne Foster's flight, obviously, which we read, that is a confession in court. Actually, part of it is a confession in prison, where she does not, she is absolutely insistent on these details. She does not diverge for one moment once she confesses. She's absolutely certain this is the way it happened, and that injury she mentions in her leg is something that only convinces her all the more that this truly had taken place. So you read these outlandish, you know, accounts of goblins in the parlor and diabolical talking cats. It's great.
I'm really interested.
I didn't have this for Cleopatra. I mean, this is
good. Yeah, that's true. And that's why I'm curious about when you have the kind of wealth of documents that you had for this, there's been a lot of accounts of the Salem witch trials. I mean, what are you looking for when you're going through these primary documents?
Well, an aerial crash is always a good place to start.
Yeah.
It occurred to me that if you could get inside the heads of these people, if you could get to the humanity, you could begin to understand how this had happened and how it rockets out of control. And then a lot of this came down to recreating the strains and the preoccupations and the fears of a 17th century New Englander, that if you could feel that, if you could hear that silence and experience that dark, and understand a little bit more about some of the terrors that women committed to the page, both spiritual and physical, you could begin to make sense of the witchcraft. And I just felt, and the more I read, the more I began to see that come emerging in the documentation. I mean, even in Tituba's documentation, you can see her tremendous fear of her master, the Reverend Paris, in whose household she's living, and her desire to give her interrogators what they're looking for. And you can see that what she is delivering is a bit of a collaboration with her interrogators. This is a story that is co-authored by an Indian slave and the authorities.
So you felt like the humanity of the people that were accused, and in some cases the accusers, was missing from a lot of the accounts that we have of it?
I feel like they had become cardboard characters to us. And you could actually, we don't have all of the documentation. The hearing papers are pretty much all we have. You could begin to recreate them as real human beings with real needs and with real grudges. There were a lot of grudges and real antipathies and real personalities.
You know, I've had a number of novelists sit there in that chair and say, I start with what if, what if, what if, what if. But that also sounds like the kind of question that somebody who does the kind of work you do would be exploring too. Are you?
That's a hard one. I think you're looking to see how did it happen more than the what if, because of course I'm not allowed to deal with the what if. That would allow my imagination to go out for a walk, which it never is.
You need your imagination for this work, don't you?
If I'd use my imagination, that broomstick crash would have been a broomstick crash, not a pole crash. No, my job, I think, is to listen to the documentation and to really pay very close attention to what's being said and what subtext is emerging without elaborating too much on it. That's why I can't draw a straight line between, for example, the sexual abuse on the records, of which there is such a quantity, and whatever these girls are suffering in 1692. It's perfectly likely, but on the page, I can't say that there is a correlation there. So now I'm a little handicapped in that respect. And I think more of my job here was to say, how did Tituba confessing somehow take us to this diabolical Sabbath, and how does that lead someone finally after 4 months of testimony in court to raise his hand and say, wait a minute, I don't really mean to question authority, but something has gone seriously awry here, and the first real hero will emerge in the story.
You know, I had the strongest sense of deja vu. I feel like we
have this conversation already?
I think in Cleopatra, because I was saying, don't you need your imagination in some ways to drive you forward to say, because as you say, there are gaps in the record. There are a lot of unknowns. But something has to bridge those unknowns for you, and I feel like, isn't that where your imagination comes into play?
I guess I would call it more, and maybe this is a cop-out, more an intuition.
Intuition.
In the sense that, for example, we don't have the voices of these afflicted girls, these girls who are suffering the effects of witchcraft. We have their words as they're recorded by the men in court. And not the first time in history that women's voices come to us filtered through men's, of course. But none of them leaves a diary. They can all write, I should add. Most of them can write. They can all read. But none of them leaves a diary. None of them would have had the time to leave a diary because she was working all day. But what we do have are those girls conversing with the devil. And it took me a long time to realize that when they converse with the devil and they report on those conversations before the authorities, they're actually saying a very great deal about what they want in life. And so I'm not sure. That's not imagination, I don't think. I would say that's more that you're reading into a text, or you're rereading a text, or you're reading between the lines of a text. And I think that's what writing this kind of history often comes down to. I mean, you're looking to see where the little grudges and antipathies rear their heads among people in a community, and what went unsaid. You know, the very fact that these 9 months during the trials go undocumented, I think speaks volumes. But of course, there I'm reasoning from a silence as well. The 1692, after it happens, it basically document-wise, those months evaporate. They disappear from sermon books. They disappear from diaries. They disappear from correspondences. I read a lot into that.
You are resisting my insistence that you're an imaginative person.
You know, my children will tell you I have no imagination.
Really?
I'm teasing. I just don't believe that.
Stacy, I don't believe that.
It's not true, but it is meant to be true for 400 or so pages of this book.
I mean, even that excerpt that you read, there was some vivid imagination at work.
I got the turtles from a captivity narrative.
Okay. I know when to give up. How about the second excerpt?
Sure.
How about that? And maybe you want to set it up just a
minute. I'm just thinking, is there anything imaginative about it? Because I'm in trouble here. This is about what happens after. This goes precisely to what we were just saying, how the trials get used in the subsequent history, and how they come back to how New England can't quite escape their legacy. The trials would take their place among those historical events that never happened until a generation or two after they did. Once they flickered back to life, they refused to dim. Of all the portents and prophecies, those of the visionary girls, the boastful specters, the Mathers, the Salem woman who forecast a second storm of witchcraft, only Thomas Brattles's came true. Ages would not wear off that reproach and those stains which these things will leave behind them upon our land. John Adams cited the trials as a foul stain upon this country, an irony for proceedings that had been intended to purify. The frenzy unleashed by a threepence duty on tea seemed to one 1773 Massachusetts lawyer absurd and more disgraceful to the annals of America than that of witchcraft. Salem came in especially handy over the second half of the 19th century. It provided an effective piece of shrapnel when North and South took aim at each other. Frederick Douglass asked how the belief in slavery was any bit less objectionable than that in sorcery. Abolition, argued others, was a hallucination on par with Salem witchcraft. The 1860 election of Lincoln struck terror in the slave-owning South, leading a popular magazine to screech, "The North, who having begun with burning witches, will end by burning us." All could agree on one matter. When you wanted to reach the emotional high notes, you reached for Salem. New England's enemies arguably did more than anyone to keep Salem alive, as for so long, the church had sustained the devil. The South woke in the 19th century to the fact that those bigoted, fanatical, mischief-making would-be enlighteners north of the Mason-Dixon line wrote the textbooks with lasting effects. Something needed to be done. The Salem misstep helped to remodel the New England past. In the midst of the Civil War, President Lincoln officially established Thanksgiving, pilgrim feasts being preferable to Puritan fasts. Decades earlier, Daniel Webster had delivered his Plymouth Rock oration, and people who had not persecuted witches or left a paper trail, or left much of any kind of trail at all, became the Ur-Americans. Blameless if colorless, the pilgrims made better ancestors than did peevish, intolerant, urban upper-class witch hunters. For a century or so, they replaced their fanatical cousins.
You ready for some audience Q&A?
Absolutely.
All right.
Audience?
As long as there are no more questions about my imagination.
Somebody help me out with that, will you? I'm going up to Matt. There you are, Matt, to ask about primary sources, right? And then raise your hand if Tracy's got a microphone over here. How am I going to get over there? Uh-oh. Let me go up here. Okay.
Thank you for being here. And thanks for having this event. It's a great time for family and friends to learn together. I teach the Crucible to high school students, and I was wondering if you could talk for a moment about some of the primary source documents that you used that would be accessible to students in a classroom.
That's a great question. There's a tremendous website, the name of which I'm going to now completely forget, which proves that I have neither imagination nor memory. It's run by UVA. If you Google Salem witch trial documentation, it will come right up. It has facsimile reproductions of almost every document you could want. And I think it's there as a teaching tool, and I think there are actually questions and capsule biographies and all kinds of other supporting materials. It's a great way of pointing out the fact that, or reminding students that, the Crucible is in fact fiction. And one of the reasons that I felt this book was necessary was because Hawthorne and Miller seem to have made off with the story so effectively. It doesn't quite happen for the way it's meant to have happened there. And it's interesting that we all come to it that way. So I think most of us were in the Crucible in high school or read it in high school. I was not cast, which is why I had to write this book. But I think we retain a sort of adolescent fascination with a fundamentally adolescent story, but based on a fictional version thereof.
Question right up there in the balcony.
Hi, my name is Holly, and I wrote my MFA thesis on the Salem witch trials and spent some time in Salem studying the archives. And I was really struck by the difference between the way Salem celebrates witchcraft today, and it made me wonder how the women and men who were accused and were put to death for witchcraft, I mean, it felt like another betrayal of them in a way, because they would not have supported that kind of celebration of witchcraft because it was so outside their worldview. And I wondered if you could speak to that, like if that occurred to you at all.
Now you tell me you had an MFA thesis I might have perjured when I wrote this book. There was a wonderful line about Salem's exploitation of the trials. When the statue of Elizabeth Montgomery went up, and a former historic commissioner said that it was like putting up a statue of Colonel Klink at Auschwitz. They've very much exploited the history. On the other hand, somebody who goes there, and there are a tremendous number, thousands and thousands of visitors to Salem, someone who goes there by definition does walk away with some heightened sense of the history. more remarkable, I think, is what has happened. Salem Village and Salem Town yet again have gone their separate ways. And Salem Village, now renamed Danvers, and I think with relief renamed Danvers, pretty much has turned its back on the past and doesn't like to refer to what happened. There is a memorial there, but they prefer to leave the matter buried. So I'm not really sure, you know, which of the two is better, that it should come out in a somewhat contorted, mutilated way, in a kitschy way, or that it not be talked about at all.
Question right over there on that side.
Hi, so I was wondering, how did you get into the, or interested in the subject of the Salem witch trials?
If only I had been cast in The Crucible, this would never have happened. A couple of things came together at once. I think I was struck as I looked at these months by the modern parallels. It is fundamentally a story about anxiety, and I feel as if, maybe I'm just speaking for myself here, but we live in an anxious age. I was very anxious for the 4.5 years I was working on this book. It's a time of immense political dislocation. The world is changing very quickly. And there's a lot of not being able to come to terms with that. There's a sense of paranoia. There's a sense of terrorists in the midst, which somehow felt to me very topical. There was also, in addition to those resonances, a feeling that women's voices, yet again, discomfited. And I, obviously, after Cleopatra, had been thinking a lot about both powerful women's voices and why a woman's voice is so strident and disabling, and about women's voices being smothered. And obviously, these bewitched girls, these afflicted girls, are in some kind of anguish that they can't articulate. And the only way they are able to articulate their distress is physically. They're trying to discharge some kind of emotion, but they don't have or can't use words for it. So on so many levels, this was a story to me about women's voices, and yet also a moment in history that is so fundamentally hardwired in the Puritan DNA, but we've forgotten. I mean, we tend to think the Puritans landed and settled, and then we had Thomas Jefferson. But there were these years in between, which we see signs of every day today.
Stacy, I've been thinking how to ask this.
Where did you go?
I'm right here.
Okay.
Sitting down.
Oh, hey, hi. I got you everywhere at once.
With the political season evolving as it is, I'm sure other people have been thinking about that too. Have you been?
You know,
what connection are you making, if any? You know what I'm asking, right?
I can't imagine what you're talking about. Yeah. Overstated national security threats are a time-honored way of doing business, right?
Yeah.
I mean, the politics of fear are very, very effective. And they were so surely at a time when the New England ministry had been preaching for a long time about conspiracy, mm-hmm. and had been warning that boatloads of Irish Catholics were about to disembark and ruin Massachusetts. You know, I mean, there was always an enemy in the offing somewhere, whether it was the swarthy, you know, Native American, or whether it was the Frenchman who was allied with him. And that was one of the parallels, obviously, that kept coming up as I was working, was this sense of someone who was the invisible forces in the air who were about to alight upon us, and trying to put a face to that faceless terror, which every time I walk through airport security, I think about. And I've been doing a lot of that.
Question right up there.
Hi, Stacy. What challenges did you encounter in your research, and what unexpected surprises did you stumble upon, maybe special delightful nuggets that you were able to include?
There were three bad surprises, I would say. The first is, why did I not know there were no 17th century newspapers in Massachusetts? And I just assumed there would be documentation. These people were three generations removed, at most, from their families in England. I assumed there would be letters back and forth about what was happening. That was a false assumption. And of course, the trial papers are missing. So those were three booby traps that I hadn't really counted on. I just assumed there had to be a lot of documentation in the English archives, where I spent a lot of time researching with very little result. And I think you always go a little bit out of your way when you work on a book like this. You think you're going to find something, and you find another rich vein elsewhere. And the happy and the difficulty, I would say, narratively, and then I'll get to the happy surprise, is this book has a fundamental problem, which is that it has a delusional event at its core, unless you believe in witches. And so you're writing about something that people are swear to in court, having sworn to tell the truth, but that in theory doesn't exist. And people are often said to be two places at once, once in their real self and once in their spectral form. And so narratively, you have a problem trying not to confuse the reader if one of the girls swears that Martha Corey is in her bed pinching her when in fact Martha Corey is safely asleep at home in her bed. So you have to make sense of those two differences. The happy surprise, I would say, is the moment that Thomas Brattle walks into the book. He's a very wealthy young Bostonian who by the end of the summer has had enough. And very tentatively, anonymously, and by a sort of underground manifesto, he writes an account of what he thinks is happening. And it's as if the Enlightenment has finally dawned. I mean, he talks about how justice has miscarried, and now how about how we can't see with our eyes closed the way the girls seem to be doing in court. And he suggests that perhaps the delusional ones are not the witches, but the justices. And what he circulates, it's not published, is very much sedition. But he basically says, at a time like this, someone has to raise his hand and speak truth to power. And I believe this is the right thing to do. And it's an extraordinary document.
Question. Oh, I'm sorry, your follow-up?
Yeah.
Where did you find Brattle's document?
It's a really great question because the original no longer exists. It's published in Burr's collection of witchcraft papers. If you can find the original, please write me. I spent countless days trying to track it down. At one point, it seems to have been in the Massachusetts Historical Society. It isn't any longer.
Question over here.
Thank you for coming. This is just so fascinating.
Thank you for
having
me.
It's incredible. But, so my question is about the connection between the European witch debacles, executions, and our own in Salem. You mentioned Sweden. I'm wondering if the people in Salem actually ever knew about all of the hundreds of thousands, whatever it was, that died in Europe. And also, I'm very fascinated by your talking about the power of the adolescence. And it seems to me that in Europe, the fear was of the power that the women had about healing, you know, the herbs and whatever in the forest, the midwifery. How would this just happen organically in another place across the world? Or did it not? Was it a spin-off of that?
There had been hundreds of years of witchcraft persecutions in Europe, pretty much everywhere. There are very few countries that are exempt from witchcraft persecutions. They had been in Russia. Obviously, Scotland had a long history of witchcraft persecution. Catholic countries had witches. Protestant countries had witches. It's a pretty non-denominational conceit. The communities from which, the counties from which these settlers came in England had very intense witchcraft prosecutions. The difference being that that had all taken place several generations earlier. By 1692, witchcraft prosecution elsewhere has pretty much come to a halt. It is not in the interest of the New England ministry to let that news, or at least skepticism about witchcraft, penetrate Boston Harbor. So the Massachusetts settler is living a generation or two behind. He's in a little bit of a time warp. And he has not yet heard that various forms of evidence, for example, that were used in 1692 in Massachusetts, were no longer being used on the continent, being used in England in any case. The idea that midwives were being persecuted or that healers were being persecuted as witches doesn't have any bearing on what happens in Massachusetts. It's really funny. I mean, that's just another one of the old shibboleths about what actually, it's like burning witches. There was no prosecution of midwives. There was a first part of your question, though. Oh, there's an earlier court case, not about witchcraft. This is a hilarious case in the quarterly court records in Massachusetts where someone in the courtroom says, it's just like the Inquisition around here, and no one knows what he's talking about. So there's the answer to your question.
How about two more questions? One up there, and then Tracy, you have one. Okay.
Hi, I should apologize to you for asking a question as a pediatrician, but I'm intrigued with the fact that many of these young girls would now be given a diagnosis rather than accused of a crime. I'd like you to say a little more about the role that Cotton Mather, as a ambitious and somewhat charismatic authority figure, had, and whether you see anything of that dynamic in some of our current controversies. The person I have in mind is Andrew Wakefield and his campaign against the measles vaccine.
You probably know that Cotton Mather's interest in the invisible world is one he carries throughout his life. And for whatever reason, he takes a very unpopular stand in the early 18th century when there's a smallpox epidemic in Boston. And he, at that point, advocates for inoculation, which seems to be, to most Bostonians, as loopy an idea as witchcraft seems to us. Everyone believes it's a hideously bad idea. Cotton Mather stands firm and strong on the idea. He is pilloried for this belief. But it seems almost a carryover of his obsession with things we can't see. It's as if he has located the right invisible world after years of belonging in the wrong believing in the wrong invisible world. But for a second time, actually for really the first time in his lifetime, he's taken to task for it. Someone throws a bomb into his house to try to kill him because of his spirited defense of inoculation. So he really believes himself a man of science. And there too, I think there's an interesting parallel with today, in that we too believe in improbable things. We just don't know which ones they are yet. And faith and evidence often contradict each other, and often we tend to revert to faith over evidence.
One last question, right over there.
Thank you. There's girls accusing mothers, grandmothers, middle-aged men. Is there any presence on the record in primary documents or in literature of any voice from adolescent boys or presence of adolescent boys being accused or being accusers?
There are adolescent boys, not initially. The only male accuser and male bewitched person originally is Tituba's probable husband, John Indian, who's also a servant in the Paris household. He too will convulse and go into trances originally. As the summer wears on, several boys will confess to witchcraft. A couple of them were tortured physically. A couple of them will testify against their parents. But by then, the pointing of fingers has become so random and so complete, it's hard to say what that was about. There had been an earlier witchcraft epidemic, and Cotton Mather plays a huge role in it, a few years earlier, in 1688, and in Boston. And in that case, several children in one very pious family, and I should say that piety and witchcraft outbreaks tended to go together, in a very pious household are afflicted, and one of those is a boy. One of the sons in the household is also affected. And in that case, the children were the children of a stone layer, and they accuse a neighborhood laundress who is hanged on Boston Common.
Stacy, not to ask you what it is that you may be working on, but I'm curious as to whether you've decided what it's going to be. The way you kind of Cleopatra led you in some ways to this.
You mean, when can I come back?
Yes. That's exactly what I'm
asking. Usually takes me about 4 years to write a book. I so hope you'll invite me back.
You've got it. Invitation now.